Children, this is my birthday, December 11th, 1890. I am 80 years old today. I was born at King's Iron Works in Sullivan County, Tennessee, December the 11th, 1810. I grew into manhood fishing in Beaver Creek and roaming through the forest, hunting the deer, the wild boar, and the timber wolf, often spending weeks at a time in the solitary wilderness with no companions but my rifle, hunting knife, and a small hatchet that I carried in my belt in all of my wilderness wanderings. On these long hunting trips, I met and became acquainted with many of the Cherokee Indians, hunting with them by day and sleeping around their campfires by night. I learned to speak their language, and they taught me the arts of trailing and building traps and snares. On one of my long hunts in the fall of 1829, I found a young Cherokee who had been shot by a roving band of hunters and who had eluded his pursuers and concealed himself under a shelving rock. Weak from loss of blood, the poor creature was unable to walk and almost famished for water. I carried him to a spring, bathed and bandaged the bullet wound, built a shelter out of bark peeled from a dead chestnut tree, nursed and protected him, feeding him on chestnuts and roasted deer meat. When he was able to travel, I accompanied him to the home of his people and remained so long that I was given up for lost. By this time, I had become an expert rifleman and fairly good archer and a good trapper, and spent most of my time in the forest in quest of game. The removal of the Cherokee Indians from their lifelong homes in the year of 1838 found me a young man in the prime of life and a private soldier in the American Army. Being acquainted with many of the Indians and able to fluently speak their language, I was sent as an interpreter into the Smoky Mountain country in May 1838 and witnessed the execution of the most brutal order in the history of American warfare. I saw the helpless Cherokees arrested and dragged from their homes and driven at the bayonet point into the stockades. And in the chill of a drizzling rain on an October morning, I saw them loaded like cattle or sheep into 645 wagons and started toward the west. One can never forget the sadness and solemnity of that morning. Chief John Ross led in prayer, and when the bugle sounded and the wagons started rolling, many of the children rose to their feet and waved their little hands goodbye to their mountain homes, knowing they were leaving them forever. Many of these helpless people did not have blankets, and many of them had been driven from home barefooted. On the morning of November the 17th, we encountered a terrific sleet and snowstorm with freezing temperatures, and from that day until we reached the end of the fateful journey on March the 26th, 1839, the sufferings of the Cherokee were awful. The trail of the exiles was a trail of death. They had to sleep in the wagons and on the ground without fire. And I have known as many as 22 of them to die in one night of pneumonia due to ill treatment, cold, and exposure. Among this number was the beautiful Christian wife of Chief John Ross. This noble-hearted woman died a martyr to childhood, giving her only blanket for the protection of a sick child. She rode thinly clad through a blinding sleet and snowstorm, developed pneumonia, and died in the still hours of a bleak winter night, with her head resting on Lieutenant Gregg's saddle blanket. I made the long journey to the west with the Cherokees, and I did all that a private soldier could do to alleviate their sufferings. When on guard duty at night, I have many times walked my beat in my blouse in order that some sick child might have the warmth of my overcoat. I was on guard the night Mrs. Ross died. When relieved at midnight, I did not retire, but remained around the wagon out of sympathy for Chief Ross, and at daylight was detailed by Captain McClellan to assist in the burial, like the other unfortunates who died on the way. Her uncoffined body was buried in a shallow grave by the roadside, far from her native mountain home. And the sorrowing cavalcade moved on. Being a young man, I mingled freely with the young women and girls. I spent many pleasant hours with them, and supposed to be under my blanket. They have many times sung their mountain songs for me, this being all that they could do to repay my kindness. And with all my association with the Indian girls from October 1829 to March 26, 1839, I did not meet one who was a moral prostitute. They're kind and tender-hearted. Many of them are beautiful. The only trouble that I had with anybody on the entire journey to the West was a brutal teamster by the name of Ben McDonald was using his whip on an old feeble Cherokee to hasten him into the wagon. The sight of that old, nearly blind creature quivering under the lashes of a bullwhip was too much for me. I attempted to stop McDonald, and it ended in a personal encounter. He lashed me across the face, the wire tip on his whip cutting a bad gash in my cheek. The little hatchet that I carried in my hunting days was in my belt, and McDonald was carried unconscious from the scene. I was placed under guard, but Ensign Henry Bullock and Private Elkanah Millard had both witnessed the encounter. They gave Captain McClellan the facts, and I was never brought to trial. Years later, I met Second Lieutenant Riley and Ensign Bullock at Bristol at John Robertson's show. And Bullock jokingly reminded me that there was a case still pending against me before a court-martial and wanted to know how much longer I was going to have the trial put off. McDonald finally recovered. And in the year 1851, was running on a boat out of Memphis. The long, painful journey to the west ended March 26th, 1839, with 4,000 silent graves reaching from the foothills of the Smoky Mountains to what is known as Indian Territory in the West. And covetousness on the part of the white race was the cause of all that the Cherokee had to suffer. Ever since Ferdinand de Soto made his journey through the Indian country in the year 1540, there had been a tradition of a rich gold mine somewhere in the Smoky Mountain country. And I think the tradition was true. In the year of 1828, a little Indian boy living on Ward Creek had sold a gold nugget to a white trader. And that nugget sealed the doom of the Cherokee. In a short time, the country was overrun with armed brigands claiming to be government agents, who paid no attention to the rights of the Indians, who were the legal possessors of the country. Chief Junaluska was personally acquainted with President Andrew Jackson. Junaluska had taken 500 of the flower of his Cherokee scouts and helped Jackson to win the Battle of the Horseshoe, leaving 33 of them dead on the field. And in that battle, Junaluska had drove his tomahawk through the skull of a Creek warrior. When the Creek had Jackson at his mercy, Chief John Ross sent Junaluska as an envoy to plead with President Jackson for protection for his people, but Jackson's manner was cold and indifferent toward the rugged son of the forest who had saved his life. He met Junaluska, heard his plea, but curtly said, "Sir, your audience is ended. There is nothing I can do for you." The doom of the Cherokee was sealed. Washington, D.C. had decreed that they must be driven west and their lands given to the white man. And in May 1838, an army of 4,000 regulars and 3,000 volunteer soldiers under command of General Winfield Scott marched into the Indian country and wrote the blackest chapter on the pages of American history. Men working in the fields were arrested and driven to the stockades. Women were dragged from their homes by soldiers whose language they could not understand. Children were often separated from their parents and driven into the stockades with the sky for a blanket and the earth for a pillow. And often the old and infirm were prodded with bayonets to hasten them to the stockades. In one home, death had come during the night. A little sad-faced child had died and was lying on a bearskin couch, and some women were preparing the little body for burial. All were arrested and driven out, leaving the child in the cabin. I don't know who buried the body. In another home was a frail mother, apparently a widow, and three small children, one just a baby. When told that she must go, the mother gathered the children at her feet, prayed in humble prayer in her native tongue, and patted the old family dog on the head, told the faithful creature goodbye, with the baby strapped on her back and leading a child with each hand, started on her exile. The task was too great for the frail mother. A stroke of heart relieved her sufferings. She sunk and died with her baby on her back and her two children clinging to her hands. Chief Junaluska witnessed this scene, the tears gushing down his cheeks. Lifting his cap, he turned his face toward the heavens and said, "Oh, my God, if I had known at the Battle of the Horseshoe what I know now, American history would have been differently written." At this time, 1890, we are too near to the removal of the Cherokees for our young people to fully understand the enormity of the crime that was committed against a helpless race. Truth is, the facts are being concealed from the young people of today. Some school children of today do not know that we are living on lands that were taken from a helpless race at the bayonet point to satisfy the white man's greed for gold. Future generations will read and condemn the act, and I do hope posterity will remember that private soldiers like myself had to execute the orders of our superiors. We had no choice in the matter. 25 years after the removal, it was my privilege to meet a large company of the Cherokee in uniform of the Confederate Army under command of Colonel Thomas. They were encamped at Zollicoffer. I went to see them. Most of them were just boys at the time of the removal, but they instantly recognized me as the soldier that was good to us. From them, I learned that Chief John Ross was still ruler of the nation in 1863. I wonder if he's still living. He was a noble-hearted fellow and suffered a lot for his race. At one time, he was arrested and thrown into a dirty jail in an effort to break his spirit. But he remained true to his people and led them in prayer when they started on their exile. And his Christian wife sacrificed her life for a little girl who had pneumonia. The Anglo-Saxon race would build a towering monument to perpetuate her noble act in giving her only blanket for comfort of a sick child. Incidentally, the child recovered. But Mrs. Ross is sleeping in an unmarked grave far from her native Smoky Mountain home. When Scott invaded the Indian country, some of the Cherokee fled to caves and dens in the mountains and were never captured. And they are there today. I've long intended going there and trying to find them, but I have put off going from year to year, and now I'm too feeble to ride that far. The fleeting years have come and gone, and old age has overtaken me. I can truthfully say that neither my rifle nor my knife are stained with Cherokee blood. I can truthfully say that I did my best for them when they certainly did need a friend. 25 years after the removal, I still live in their memories. The soldier who was good to us. However, murder is murder. Whether committed by the villain skulking in the dark, or by uniformed men stepping to the strains of martial music. Murder is murder. And somebody must answer. Somebody must explain the streams of blood that flowed in the Indian country in the summer of 1838. Somebody must explain the 4,000 silent graves that marked the trail of the Cherokees to their exile. I wish I could forget it all. But the picture of 645 wagons lumbering over the frozen ground with their cargo of suffering humanity still lingers in my memory. Let the historian of a future day tell the sad story with its sighs, its tears, and dying groans. Let the great judge of all the earth weigh our actions and reward us according to our work. My children, thus ends my promised birthday story. This, December the 11th, 1890. John G. Burnett.